Welcome to the Therapeutic Food Solutions Podcast. I'm your host, Marian Mitchell. I'm an integrative nutrition health coach, therapeutic diet expert, and founder of The Road to Living Whole. There are many different diets out there. It's hard to know which one is right for you with your chronic illness and autoimmune disease. In this podcast, I'm going to share with you the foundational pieces every single therapeutic diet out there shares, and also how to use the best one for your particular diagnosis. If you've been looking for a meal planning partner, help navigating the complicated healthcare system, and want to feel better quickly, I'm your girl. Grab your kombucha and notebook. Let's dive in. Back with me today is John Gusty. Back in April, he joined me and we talked about owning your health outcomes. Well, today we are diving further and we're going to deconstruct different facets of the health and wellness industry and things that you really need to know about it to get a full understanding of what it takes to truly live a healthy life beyond just things that we tend to compartmentalize and think are separate are really all tied together. So I'm really excited to dive into this. John, thank you so much for joining me again. Can you give us a quick intro and then we're going to start diving in?
Yeah, Mary. Well, first of all, thanks for having me back. John Gusty, live west of Nashville, Tennessee, co-authored a book with four of probably some of my best friends on earth, four UK chaps. And that book is called The Red Pill Revolution. And we started writing that book in fourth quarter of 2019. I think we all know what happened next. And that book was originally set out to make it as, and it's ironic what happened next, but the whole point of the book was to offer a sane, rational, calm-toned approach to the wacky world that we live in, the politics, the religion, the media, the corporate, all of that stuff. And then, of course, we end up writing it during, you know, the one of the biggest psyops of certainly of my life, I'm sure of most people's lives. But I think it was a blessing in disguise because it's really given the project legs and we're able to keep this conversation going and probably will for many, many, many more years. So it's been awesome to be able to talk to people about so many different subjects. And hey, I want to give a shout out to you and your audience. My publicity team, the amazing folks at Command Your Brand, Jeremy and Rebecca over there, they've probably had me on 30 plus podcasts, and a few really, really stood out as just outstanding conversations. And yours was absolutely one of, if not the one of the more enjoyable ones. And I'll tell you why, because, you know, I think a lot of people have their little niches that they play in. And of course, you know, you play in the health and wellness niche. But what I really loved about our past conversation, and I think it's a struggle for a lot of people trying to figure out the world these days, is everything is connected. And you can't talk about health and wellness without talking about government, without talking about corporations, without talking about the legal system versus the lawful system. You can't, I mean, it's all connected. And you are one of the few that just, you're open to the connectedness of it all. And so thanks for having me back. And I hope this is time well spent for your audience.
I have no doubt. And thank you. You know, one of the things that I think is coming out on the podcast this year, and I'm really excited to talk about it, is just that health is not just like one dimensional. Like, yes, we know we need food and sleep and clean water and all this stuff, but what it takes to get that is a lot more complicated than we think in today's world. And, you know, I've had three or four out of you guys from Red Pill Revolution on the podcast lately. And it takes the scope and the depth of the health and wellness world so much deeper, because there is so much at play. That, you know, I've been in the health world for over 12 years, right? And I think even longer than that. And it's just like, I've gone through all these stages of learning and shock and awe and anger and acceptance and, you know, what role can I play in this and how can I help make the world a better place? And, you know, a lot of people, especially when they're like newly diagnosed with, you know, chronic disease and stuff, and they realize that the medical system is not helping them and they have to go outside of that and they have to own their health, it's overwhelming. They don't know where to begin. And it truly is multifaceted. So I'm excited that we get to dive deeper into that.
Yeah. And I think you just hit on something that I think is a fundamental pillar of understanding that I think a lot of people, they don't start from this perspective. And it's the perspective of there is a really big difference between health and wellness. And that's a big topic area. And there's a lot of people playing in that space. So you've got health and wellness over here, and you have the medical industrial complex over here. I'm never at a loss for silly analogies. So let me offer one here if this helps people kind of get what I'm saying. You could make the argument that the fast food industry is definitely in the nutritional space, the nutritional dietary space. But would anyone sanely look, when they're not the only one in that space, but would anyone sanely look to the fast food industry to be the be all end all source of information for your nutritional health? And of course the answer is no. They are not, their objective is not to keep you healthy. Their objective is to sell you things and make those things as delicious and as tempting as possible. And so I think the sane amongst us look at the fast food industry at the very least as just maybe a treat, a naughty treat, maybe, but you certainly wouldn't go to that industry for your nutritional guidance. And by the same, well, you shouldn't. Yeah. And by the same token, you can make a direct comparison to the medical industrial complex. That's kind of like the fast food of your health, but that's so hard for some people to grasp. It's like, because we've been born, it's just been embedded into our psyches that these people with white lab coats and letters after their name have some sort of magical power or superior understanding of things. And I don't know, anyone that's ever done even 10, 15 minutes of research into what a typical MD ends up knowing. I mean, it's almost cliched now that most people know that, like, if you go to become a medical doctor, there's not a whole lot of, if any, focus on nutrition or food or any of that stuff. So,
or even self-care at home, teaching people how to take care of themselves at home. It's literally just symptoms, pills, symptoms, surgery. And it's unfortunate. Like, my favorite doctors are the ones that are like in their 70s that don't want to retire because they understand, wet socks and drink honey with lemon, honey lemon water for a cough.
Yeah. They remember that they're probably the last of the generation that had a little bit of that homeopathic, if something works, it works. But the medical industrial complex has been, ever since the Rockefeller forces established it, has been trying to stamp out or minimize or even turn into outright quackery things like, the power of like what something simple as like apple cider vinegar, what that could do. They would rather sell you an artificial substance, tell you, to use apple cider vinegar for things. And there's countless examples of that. But, but the medical industry only have three tricks. They're gonna cut you, they're gonna drug you, or they're gonna burn you with radiation. That's all they do. And it's kind of like the fast food industry has only got a few tricks, and it's sugar, salt, and
MSG. Almost,
food porn like imagery. Look at this hot fudge sundae. You want this hot fudge? So I think that fast food analogy, you can take that any vertical. You could take it in if all you're consuming for your information is mainstream corporate government news like Fox, CNN, the BBC. If that's all you're consuming, then you're consuming fast food information. And over a course of time, if that's all you're consuming, your informational health is going to be subpar. If all you're eating is fast food, your actual health is going to be subpar. So we need to, if through these types of conversations, if we can help people who may not be looking at it quite the way that you and I look at it, if we can just offer them, offer them an example of like, hey, look, I haven't put any of their products in me or on me in probably 20 years, and I'm better off for it. And I think most of us who have taken that path are better off for it. And I avoid their stuff like I avoid fast food or like I avoid fast food information. It's not healthy for me.
Yeah, it's so true. And our goal today is to offer another perspective and give you food for thought, because it's so easy to kind of get wrapped up in the noise. In the health and wellness world, there's a lot of noise out there, and really you can break it down into different categories. And there's just a lot of learning with all of those, if you can understand that they're all interconnected and you don't have to know everything, but we're going to give you some information today. And so we want to deconstruct kind of health and wellness and really kind of give people this different perspective on it and this more holistic perspective on it. And, you know, your biggest passion is that people understand that there are these different categories and they're all interconnected. So let's move on from fast food and let's talk, you know, the fast food example, which I love. I love the examples that you give. The illustrations are beautiful. You know, let's talk about maybe the different things that are just bombarding our health that we don't think about. You know, you talked about CNN and, you know, news related media and how poisonous that can be. Let's talk about that. I think, you know, a lot of people, like my grandma loves the news, right? She has to watch it every day. But then she also thinks that like there's all this evil running around in the world and she's kind of scared of the world, you know? And it's unfortunate, I think. So maybe I know a lot of people are running into that. Things are so divisive right now. I would love to talk about that.
I've always and maybe you've noticed this too over the years, but the more you find out about the deceptive, darker side of anything, you realize one common thread that I've noticed is how blatant and in the open some of this is. I mean, we'll take media. I mean, we have grown up knowing the term programming, but we don't think anything about, most people don't think about that word. They're using that word quite, you know, I mean, boldly. I mean, how many times have you seen somebody on social media go, I need a new thing to watch? Like, what, you know, I've gone through this particular series and now I need a new thing to watch. And that programming is just as addictive as the tobacco industry has made cigarettes, or just as the sugar industry has made sugar. You know, I mean, it's, if you are a profit driven entity, you have to hook your customers. You have to. And hooking your customers isn't always bad. I mean, if you're offering a good, honest, you know, noble, healthy service or good, I mean, it's, yeah, you'll hook the customer on the integrity and the honor of your brand. But that is not the case with major mainstream media of any kind. I mean, there's, you know, we've grown up in this, there's this fake paradigm of this right versus left, red versus blue. And it's so, I hope with the ridiculousness of the last 3-4 years, that more and more people are seeing that it is a religion. I mean, people who believe in it's statism, people that believe in the state, they believe in the District of Columbia. Okay. That's a religion. It's a higher authority. Just like, you know, religion is belief in higher authorities. People really believe that little 10 square mile area, you know, called the District of Columbia actually has authority over everyone, and people willingly submit, just like people in, you know, any other religion willingly submit to that power and got their sacred texts and their funny robes and their ceremonies and all of that. But it's the same church, you know, the red people sit on the one side of the church and the blue people sit on the other side of the church, but it's the same church. And if you can approach that media as there isn't two sides, you know, the CNN people and the Fox News people are not on opposite sides of the ideology. They're in the same church. They believe that entity that they believe in, the District of Columbia, which is a commercial entity, has the right to tell you and I and everybody else what to think, what to eat, what to grow, where to live, who owns what, boundary, all these types of things.
Health
yeah, all
insurance,
of that stuff.
How you can take care of yourself, everything.
And one of the most like egregious things, I'll tie this back to, you know, health and wellness. One of the most just sickening aspects of where we've gotten ourselves to as a species, first and foremost, the number one thing that we are is made up of water. And water is so key. Like if we could start thinking of ourselves as aquariums and treating ourselves like someone who has, I mean, we've all known people who have, you know, hundreds, if not thousands of dollars tied up in aquariums and the lights and the coral and the, you know, and the plants and all of that stuff. And they would never think of throwing tap water in there because they know exactly what would happen. The plants would die, the fish would die. But we in mass throw crappy water into our aquariums all the time and don't even think about it. This system, this paradigm that we live in, we've got to be the only organism, the only species on Earth that puts a commercial paywall between like us and water. It literally falls from the sky, pours from the ground. It's everywhere. Why is any human being paying for water? And why are we not taught the importance of water when we are arguably 70, 80% water, depending upon who you want to argue with? Think about the ridiculousness of that. We should be taught at birth how to harvest and store water and how to keep that water. I mean, that water is life. But yet, you know, most of us get water through it's piped in through some gross, you know, system from some gross processing plant somewhere, and a processing plant is dumping who knows what into that water. I think it would behoove everyone to take a trip down to their local water company and take a look at like some of the stuff they're putting into
the water. Oh, and some of the stuff they can't filter out. They don't have processes in place to remove pharmaceuticals. Mm-hmm. So there's birth control in water and psych meds in mm-hmm. water that you're drinking from the tap. And it's really unfortunate. They're transparent about it if you look for it, but you have to know what you're looking for. And I mean, I get an annual water report of like chemicals that are found, and if they're, you know, in the legal limits or if they're above the legal limits, they say they're honest about it, because I've seen plenty that are way too high. But then if you dig down the rabbit hole of, well, what are these chemicals and what do they do? And you realize that they're hormone endocrine disruptors, mm-hmm. right? And like right now, Robert Kennedy Jr. made atrazine super popular, and everybody's researching atrazine and how it turns frogs into genderless or female, you know, male frogs become genderless or female. And, you know, and the EPA just decided a 50% increase in the limit that they use on, you know, it's a pesticide.
Like
they use it on food
or something. Oh my
and
gosh.
Then it goes into our water, you know, and it goes into the plants. They don't have an ability to filter it out. So, you know, we're drinking it, showering in it, all of these things. And, you know, really, it's like the power comes when people are educated and can demand change, right? Like that's where the power is. And like, cause it's really overwhelming to think about. There's all these things, you know, that are frustrating that our government allows to happen for whatever reason they're bought and paid for. But the more we know about it, the more we can raise our voices, and the more we can say something, the more filters that we can buy, we can learn what filters we need to do. We can learn about showerhead filters. We can learn about all these things and what we can do, which is great, but it's demanding change.
Yeah.
Right.
Yeah. I interfaced with my water company, and I took them to task on what they were putting in. My wife suffers from, she's got a pretty bad neurological scenario. And, you know, I was wanting them to take hydrofluoric silicic acid out of the water. And they were actually really nice about it. I had to chuckle when I went in there. Three older gentlemen, I went to the monthly meeting, and they're like, "You're the first person who's attended one of these meetings in years," you know? And so, and we they were really kind, and they answered all my questions. And we, you know, I asked to see the packaging that the hydrofluoric silicic acid comes in. And, you know, it showed me all of that. I asked him, I said, "Hey, look, you know, you don't have to put this in there. You're not mandating, you know, you're not mandated by anything that I'm aware of. Why are you doing it?" And they're like, "Well, we just have always done it." And I was like, "Well, could you stop? because I'm your customer and I would like you to stop doing that. They said, well, let's look into why we're doing it and why we were even doing it in the first place. And I went to the next meeting 30 days later, and there must have been 22, 24 additional people in there other than me. And they were all from the state of Tennessee. They contacted the state, and the state descended upon our little water district like a swarm of bees. And they had, there was half the people in there were lawyers. And you come to find out that, you know, years and years ago, back in the 50s, the aluminum industry struck a deal with the dental industry and the water infrastructure throughout the country. And, you know, hydrofluoric silicic acid is a byproduct of aluminum production. And the aluminum industry was dumping it. Then people were started dying, and plants and animals started dying. And they brought it to, you know, took them to task. And this was in the mid 50s thereabouts. And so, I guess it was some sort of a win-win that instead of dumping it in the earth and killing and harming, you know, a small group of people, we'll put it in the water supply and even it out. We'll take this highly corrosive toxic substance and put it in the water supply. And wait, corrosive, who could benefit from that? The dental industry, you know, I mean, the dental industry is a relatively new industry. You know, I mean, it wasn't really the introduction of sugar into the modern diet really caused a lot of that. But then you also have, you know, water supplies that have this acid in it. It's, you know, slowly corroding people's teeth. And that's great for the dental industry. So industry-wise, it was a win-win. But I mean, like, most people don't even know the history of that. And it's pretty well documented. I mean, I've got a stack of books downstairs that I think the earliest one was 1952, written by medical professionals when this whole practice started. And, you know, the whole theme of everything was like, what in the world are we doing? We can't put that stuff in the water supply, but, you know, it's in there and it's still in there to this day. And, you know, so I did what I could. I pressed all the buttons that I could press, but then I took it into my own hands and I stopped being a customer and I dug a well, and the well cost me what your average, you know, family of five probably spend on an annual vacation. And instead of going to Disneyland or going on a cruise, I just dug a well and now I have my own water, and it's not an issue. I have control over my water now. I distill it, and all the water that I either drink or expose myself and my family to is at least I know what's not in it. Because I take everything out through distillation.
Yeah. Going back to the government and how it impacts the health and wellness of the people, especially, I mean, it's all countries. I feel like America is especially, our government is especially bought out because we have so many things that are allowed in our food and allowed to be sprayed on our food that other countries have banned and or severely limited long, long ago, right? There's all these comparisons between, like, you know, Food Babe talks about this, like, oh, you know, if you compare American made product with the European product and how much shorter the list is. And, you know, ours has like all these food additives and food coloring and binders and thickeners and like all of this stuff that's really detrimental to our health, but the government allows it. And they say that it's completely fine and healthy. Do they really have our best interest heart?
My starting point is I don't think we need to refer to it as our government because we actually don't have anything to do with it. I mean, at least people will argue the date, but at least from, you know, the early 30s onward, I haven't lived a day of life on earth since my birth, where we have had government. We don't have government. We have these commercial entities, you know, acting as government, but they're not actual government, and the people are not in charge or influential in any way. I mean, we go through lots of us go through the voting ritual, you know, but I mean, the mere fact that we don't elect any of those people, you know, you can look into even the whole electoral college, you know, which is these are commercial entities, and the electoral college is actually the board, and the board elects the people who are in charge of the commercial entity. But
they're the ones that are in charge of what's allowed in our food, allowed to be sprayed.
We don't
on
have
it.
To eat their food.
Right. But for people who are starting this journey, right? So if we think about that, they're coming to the realization, okay, doctors aren't helping me. The food's poison, you know, but what's the root of that? And the root of that is that we do participate in buying their food. So how do we get out of that? Where does one begin? And for me, I just think about first of all, switching to real food and getting, mm-hmm. you know, and that's like start, you know, yes, food is heavily sprayed, but the foods that are most heavily sprayed are wheat, oats, corn, right? Like those are like the big ones yeah. that get sprayed.
And you don't really
right?
need any of those.
Any of those.
Yeah. You don't need any
no,
of those.
You really, you don't need any of that. You know, people are more worried about like GMOs and things like that. And I'm like, my biggest concern is the pesticides mm-hmm. and the herbicides and the fungicides. And so it's like the more we can escape that and just eat real food. And then if you take it a step further, once you're used to eating real food, then you take a step further and you start buying local, getting to know your local farmers, your local ranchers,
right,
you know, and it's not always easy. At first, until you, for one, change your habit, you find the people, you get to know them. Like it's a process of building relationships with these people and buying local and finding out where do you buy the local stuff? Because in Arizona, our farmers markets are basically just buying a bunch of knickknacks. There's mm-hmm. very little food at our farmers markets out here.
Yeah. I grew up in Tempe. So
you know, but what's funny is that there's these food boxes you can buy every week. And they are from local farmers and everybody just kind of gets a little bit of everything from all these different farmers. And you get this amazing amount of produce that tastes better than you could ever experience. You don't know the farmers, but you know, like the company gets them from all the local farmers and it's like a co-op of farmers. They all grow different things and they all go in together, you know? And so that's really big here in Arizona. But if you go back east and then to the south where there's a lot more farms and local farms and small farms, you can really... You have access to more things than a lot of people do,
and I don't think we should underestimate what we can all do for ourselves. And I mean, and you know, it is a enormous lifestyle change for somebody who is used to just going to their grocery store whenever they want and picking something up. What was a big wake up call for I think a lot of people was early into the events of 2020, remember the great toilet paper shortage, you know, and like what that was kind of silly in retrospect, but like what came after that. And I mean, still there's lots of our brothers and sisters in the UK and beyond who still can't go to the store and get bacon, you know, just essentials. And we just take for granted that that's where our food comes from. Our food comes from stores. And we need to change our mindset. And like, that's not how any other species thinks. That's not how birds think, fish think, dogs think, cats think, cows think. Their food comes from them. They go get their own food. And what could be more important? What's a more important priority than nourishing yourself? So I just think we need to shift. There needs to be and it's happening. I mean, I see it everywhere and I think you do too, but there needs to be a massive shift away from the things that most people consider priorities. Most people consider priorities to be their cable bill or their phone or their car or their, you know, that kind of stuff. And I realize that for some people in day-to-day life, those are necessities, but you know, what is going to happen when those things go down, stop working? And you know, we will live to see, even if it's an intentional, something as simple as like an intentional electromagnetic pulse event, whether it's terrorist or instigated by the powers that shouldn't be. But, you know, we will live to see, I predict it's going to take place in the next year or so. You know, some sort of electromagnetic pulse event where phones stop working or electronics stop working for a period of time. And, you know, when you can't whip out your plastic card and give it to the cashier at the store for your packaged stuff, whatever it is that you might be buying, how are you going to feed yourself? How are you going to get water? And so if we could just start looking at our basic necessities with a little bit more of the responsibility on ourselves, you know, like regardless of where you live, there is somebody growing something, or somebody has chickens. I mean, there's, and even if you live in an apartment, you can still grow a lot of stuff. And I realize that's not the be all end all, but it's a really good start. It's anything that you can consume that came from you, that you made happen, I think is a win. And you kind of get on a little bit of a adrenaline rush when you start doing it. And you're like, you know, I grew this tomato, or, you know, or I, you know, even if you didn't do it, like I have a lot of farmer relationships, and it's like, I haven't actually bought food from the store in many, 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 many years. But like when I am eating a steak or a burger or whatever, like I know where that came from. It not only tastes better, but I know, because I know where it came from and I know the people behind it, I know it's healthier for me. And it just, I don't know, it just, it's, it, there's some sort of pride that you get from just knowing, hey, I made this happen. I didn't just go to Kroger and get it, you know?
Yeah. I think one of the things that when you start owning your health is the empowerment that comes with it. And part of being empowered is knowing where your food comes from. And, you know, there is this push of like humane farming and like this, you know, one of the, you know, biggest reasons why people will go vegan is because they hate how animals are treated, right? You know, on these mass farms by these, you know, big ag companies that are really not ag related. They're just, you know, market, you know, money driven companies that don't really care about health. They just care about profit, right? And that's not all of them. I know plenty of cattle ranchers who raise their cows and then sell them at auction. Mm. You know, they're living on grass for the first two, three years of their lives before they go to slaughter, right? But I think, especially when you're dealing with disease, which, you know, so many of us are, you know, and when we're getting into food and so you start eating healthier, right? You start going to the grocery store, you're buying different things, but then you start realizing what's in your food. And it's like this progression of things. And I, you know, it's funny because I'm in this world all the time and I think it's normal. And then I talk to somebody who's not in this world and I feel like I'm like an alien. Like they're looking at me like I'm insane. And I think that some people listening to this might be like, whoa, this is like really intense and out there. But it's really just kind of the progression of learning to own your health is like, first you just start learning, okay, I need to eat real food. I need to learn how to cook it. But then you start realizing, oh, there's still a bunch of crap in there. So what can you, you know, what can I do? And like, I have a black thumb. I can't really grow things, unfortunately. And I don't really have the time to learn. But even now, like there's people that if I were to put planter boxes in my yard, there are urban farmers that I could, that will come and I can pay them and they'll take care of my garden for me every week. And I get the food from that. But like what I do is I do the boxes and, you know, the local farmers and buy, you know, get meat delivered or, you know, things like that. Like there's so many different options out there, but it's really just the more you can depend on yourself and not on others and knowing what's in your food and where it comes from, the better you'll be because you're in charge of your health and you're not outsourcing it. And I think that's really the thing I think that I want to drive home in this podcast that I think is our goal is that when you start taking control of your health, it becomes this holistic thing, right? Like you start breaking free of being dependent on others and becoming self-sufficient. And that's really empowering. Yeah. And it's transformative of our mental health, our emotional health, our spiritual health, our physical health, all of it, all encompassing.
Yeah. And it's a huge transition for a lot of people, because again, we were born into this mentality, even the term healthcare. Like a lot of people think of healthcare as this administrative privilege that you are given most likely through your employer to have access to government pharmaceutical surgery, radiation advice, whatever. And that's what most people think of as healthcare. And it's like, why it has been a question that I'll probably always continue to be fascinated by. Why in the world would we turn over the number one responsibility that we have to ourselves, which is our health? Why would we turn that responsibility over to a third party? Why would we? Yeah, I mean, you wouldn't even do that. Like you wouldn't think of other things in your life that you wouldn't do that with. Like you wouldn't, you know, you wouldn't turn the responsibility of, you know, your pets over to a third party. I mean, I don't know, maybe some people do, but, you know, but you wouldn't turn the responsibility of your children over to a third party. Like, why are we turning our biggest, like, if we aren't healthy, we can't be there for our pets or our children or our significant others. And so many of us think that health care is this administrative thing that gives us access to corporate government stuff. And I haven't lived a day in my life that I haven't known. And I think we all know it's literally a pop culture meme that government, corporations, politicians, they're not our friends. They're not looking out for us, the individuals. They are entities that are self-perpetuating. They're there for their own existence.
Yeah, I want to talk about healthcare because my story with kind of getting disillusioned with it was during my first marriage, my then husband quit his job and we lost our health insurance. And then I bought just a plan off of the marketplace and it covered most things, but it wouldn't cover my asthma, wouldn't cover my son's vaccinations, which at the time I was vaccinating. And it didn't cover like pretty much anything. It really was just for emergencies or if I was like really sick and I couldn't figure it out. So during that time, I learned how to treat conditions. Like I had chronic sinus infections and I learned, you know, a neti pot and oregano oil got rid of them better. And I didn't have gut problems from them. And I learned that, you know, food triggered my migraines and my psoriasis and I learned how to treat sore throats using herbs and, you know, homeopathic remedies. And like all of a sudden, the only time I needed a doctor was if something was broken.
Yeah. Well, something structural. Yeah. Yeah.
Or an infection that with my kids, like they just, it wouldn't go away. Right. They weren't getting better after 2 weeks. I was like, okay, let's go, you know, and you know, my daughter has a heart defect. Yeah. Structural stuff. Right. So that type of stuff, like I'm so grateful for modern medicine because it's really great for the structural stuff, but it's, you know, but that's where it ends. And I think that when we can own our health and then we know, and then with the structural stuff, we do have that, but it's not that expensive when you know how to navigate it, even cash pay. You know, my mom's a medical biller and I haven't had health insurance for years. And I'm like, if I ever go to a hospital and I something's happened, I know how to make it affordable. Right. And I think a lot of people just come to this point where you cannot outsource your health anymore. And then realize it's the most empowering thing on the planet, but it is hard to wrap your mind around. Like I had chronic migraines and I was taking a pharmaceutical 3 times a week just to be able to function and graduate from college. You know, when it turned out that all I had to do was stop eating corn, you know, and
all those things that you mentioned, like the neti pot, that's not new knowledge. That knowledge has been around for
thousands of years. Yeah. And that's how I learned was just like these people who went the naturopathic route, learned how to take care of themselves, and they taught me their knowledge. And that's how medicine was, very effective medicine. They, you know, there's places that the medicine woman will use banana leaves and some salve and then, you know, cut huge gashes or close the next day. Yeah. And we can't even wrap our heads around that in modern America, you know, and first world countries. We're like, really, these third world countries have better healthcare. They know how to do C-sections and heal those C-sections and prevent death and childbirth. You think that, oh, if you're not in a first world country, you're just dying of childbirth. And no, birth problems have been around forever and they have solutions for them. And it's just so interesting to me how we outsource our healthcare when really there's so much knowledge in the world that if we took advantage of it, everybody would be better.
And their system, the corporate structure, the corporate schools, the corporate media, the corporate food, the corporate medical, all of that corporate structure is not going to teach you that. Because it's not part of their business model, you know. Right. Having sustainable health and people not, that model is, it's like subscription through prescription. You know, it's like they're trying to hook you and get you on their products.
So I have an analogy or an illustration for that. We joke about this. So in the naturopathic world, we always talk about how we're a pyramid. It's an upfront investment. But as you learn how to take control of your health, we work ourselves out of a job. Your cost mm-hmm. initially is more expensive than what you're used to. But, you know, within a year, maybe 18 months, if that long, you don't need a doctor anymore. You don't need a health coach anymore. But then in the allopathic model, it's an upside down yep. pyramid where the upfront cost is very low because you're just paying your copay, you know, but then you're not getting better. So then you have to go see a specialist and you have to get all these tests and these scans. And then you're still not getting better. And then you're getting injections. And then you're, you know, getting, you know, and then your prescriptions start growing because there's, you know, side effects. And then you have to counter those side effects. And then all of a sudden you're spending, you know, thousands of dollars a month and a year. And so it gets bigger as time goes on. And so when you are willing to trust people who use an integrative approach and learn and are educating you on how to take care of yourself, you're going to save yourself thousands of dollars. Plus have the pride in knowing if something happens, I'll be okay, which is, I think, huge. I love that. I don't like depending on anybody. Like, I want to know that if something happens, I know how to take care of myself, or I know what questions to ask if I can't, you know. It's just, it's huge.
Yeah. You meant you too, like myself, I haven't had medical insurance, and I don't even remember. It was years and years and years ago, and that'll come up in conversation from time to time, and there'll be people around me go, oh my gosh, what are you going to do if something happens? And I was like, well, what do you think is going to happen? You know, what if you get sick if something happens to me. Just like if something happens to my car or if something happens to my dog, we will address it. But I will be the general contractor of that. Like I'm not going to bring in somebody else who from an industry that I already know I can't trust to work on my problem.
Well, it's like people say, oh, what if you get cancer? And I'm like, well, if I went cancer, I wouldn't be doing chemo and radiation anyways. I'd be going to the Gerson clinic, you know, like I would not be going that route at all. There's other routes that are much more effective, you know? And I think that, again, that's part of the education is like, now, if I break a bone, okay, I can have them set it and give me a cast. You know, my daughter has a heart defect. If she needed heart surgery, you know, I want her in the hospital getting heart surgery. I trust her. Her cardiologist is an amazing, amazing person who sat down and spent an hour and a half with me that first appointment explaining everything. And, you know, he sees us every year and I love him to death, you know, but it's like, again, like, even if that happened, yeah, her appointments are expensive, but I have to wonder, like, if we didn't have health insurance, would they cost 13 grand a year? You know, would we be doing the tests that they're doing that they know insurance covers, right? And so it's a very interesting thought and such a paradigm shift. And, you know, for people who are really new to this, this episode's going to be really out there. But bear with us, because as you do your research and maybe 5, 10 years from now, you're going to be like, dang, they really knew what they were talking about. Because I remember being in that spot where like, I was just learning so much, and you get from shocked to angry to like, okay, how do I flip off the system?
You know, I just thought of something, and maybe this is, you know, for those people, you know, you'd mentioned, you know, people who are new to this, this might be a shock. Here's a little test that that you can do, and this is something that actually really happened to me. So got two boys, and both are huge into soccer. And years ago, my oldest, he had a situation with his knee that we needed a X-ray done, and so I just happened to know where there was a radiology office, and I called up and I made an appointment. And even that was kind of fun, because they're like, well, who is the who is the doctor? And I was like, there is no doctor, I just want to make an appointment. Okay, you know, put you down. And so I go there for my appointment, and the very, you know, I say who I am, time of the appointment, and the very next thing the lady asked me for, she said, can I see your insurance card? And I was like, what does insurance have to do with this? I'm just here for an X-ray. This is cash, but there's no reason to bring insurance into this. How much is an X-ray? you know? And she fumbles around and I go sit down and my name gets called and take my son there and we get the x-ray and we're checking out. And the x-ray ended up being like $39.95. And I paid it. I wanted to make sure I paid it. Got my receipt first. And then I asked the lady, I said, hey, let me ask you something. There wasn't a line behind me, so I wasn't that guy. I was like, let me ask you something. If I would have pulled out like a Blue Cross Blue Shield card and gave you that, you know, what would my copay have been for this? And the copay was $75. So the copay was 75.
The secrets of the trade.
The copay was 75, but like if you drop insurance out of the equation altogether and go, how much does this cost? $39.95. It's like, so
I have a similar story. So my friend 3 years ago was pregnant, didn't have insurance, right? Or her insurance was really, really crappy and wouldn't cover a lot of things. So she just decided for the ultrasound to go cash pay. Didn't even tell them she had insurance. She called like 6 different ultrasound places and the prices varied wildly. Some of them were like $139 all the way down to $40. Right. And the same for MRIs. I know people who don't have insurance that need MRIs, and it's anywhere from $5,000 to $200 if you're willing to shop around. Right. So it takes a bit more time, but it's not as expensive as you would think. Yeah. You know, it's very, very interesting. Like, people think like, oh, if you don't have insurance and you need something beyond, you know, the regular cold and flu or whatever, like, you're going to be bankrupt and die. Actually, insurance is probably going to bankrupt you a whole lot faster, you know, because of the premiums and then the co-pays and, you know, the stuff that's not covered, less and less is covered every year. And so it's like, for me, you know, again, I don't have structural issues, right? I mean, I have asthma, I deal with like ear infections and stuff, but I know how to manage those with lifestyle. And so again, it's not a big deal because I don't have to worry about it. But at the same time, even if you have structural issues, there's, if you're willing to put in the time and the effort, it's not as, it's cheaper.
Yeah. And the, it really the is. Biggest thing about being a cash pay person, whether you have insurance or not, if you go into an office or a scenario and just, you know, announce that you are cash pay, the biggest shift for me and the most important aspect of that is you are now in charge. You are an actual customer. If you're going through insurance, you have zero say and just about you're going to take what they give you. They're going to take what they approve or what is approved or whatever. But when you're cash pay, you call the shots. I years ago, I woke up one morning and I was blind in this eye. I just woke up, was in the shower, and I was like, what in the world is going on? And I went through all the different scenarios. What, did I just have a stroke? What is going on? Turns out my retina had fallen off in my sleep. Apparently I have crazy REM, rapid eye movement when I sleep. And that is a sign of an overactive, which may be guilty of that. you might be as well, but I basically shook it off. It just disconnected from the back of my eye. So again, structural issue. I went to an eye surgeon who was a very nice gentleman and obviously in a bit of a panic, and we got in there and within 24 hours, within 12 hours, it was reattached. And, but it was pretty brutal surgery and all, but, and then 14 days later, it fell off again and I had to go through the exact same thing. So, I got to know this gentleman, my eye surgeon, very, very well. And he definitely knew where I was coming from ideologically. You know, he knew that I was, you know, I don't step foot inside hospitals lightly. Like, that is not where, you know, I want to be, for a plethora of reasons. But after that, after the second reattachment, I was diving into the whole subject of eye health and what can I do to get my nurse, my eye back to health. And, I mean, 30 minutes into researching this, you find out that, like, you know, blue light in general is just awful. It's just awful for in so many ways, like it messes up the circadian rhythm and all of that. But like blue light from screens and from the LED, anything LED is awful for your eyes. And it was like number one thing, like, do not expose your your healing retina to any blue light. Just make it natural light. I learned that on my own. And the other thing was how healing UV light is, you know? And so the two things that my eye surgeon should have told me, you know, post-op health would be stay away from blue light and get as much UV as possible. Get out in the sun, look into the sun, you know, if at all possible.
Oh, that's counter the government guidelines. You can't do that.
I got to know this guy well enough that like, I called him out on it. I went, cause we had these follow-up visits and that I was paying cash for. So I was the boss. And I was like, this follow-up visit, we're going to talk. And I was like, why didn't you tell me this? And it was kind of deer in the headlights. I was like, you've, I was sitting in his office and he's got all these plaques and all these years of achievement. I was like, 30 minutes online, I came across some pretty foundational stuff that you should have told me. Why didn't you tell me? Like, I'm paying you cash. We're not messing with insurance. Be honest with me. Tell me why you didn't tell me. And his answer was pretty much, and I'm paraphrasing. He said, look, I'm a licensed practitioner and there's a template that I have to follow and there are guidelines and there are things that I can and cannot recommend. He said, there are conversations I can and can't have with you. And he's like, that just did not fall into that category. And I was dumbfounded. I was like, you've got to be kidding me. I was like, cash pay or not, you're in the business of eye health and you just reattached my retina for the second time in 2 weeks. The first thing you should have told me was to stay away from blue light. What sort of commercial government crap are you operating under that would keep you from telling me that information?
The licensing body, he could lose his ability to practice. Yeah.
And that's really what it was. I was like, it's unbelievable. I was like, I don't know, man. I don't know how you people saying this to him. I was like, I don't know how you people operate like that when you know what is right and what is wrong. You just can't say it. And why you agree to that? One thing to be a shiesty salesman if you're selling like office furniture or shoes or something like that. But this is my eyesight. This is people's health, you know, life and death in some cases. And that information that anybody listening to this, that if anything sinks in, just know there is a ton of information that medical professionals know that is right. They just can't say it to you. They cannot, in their capacity, tell you these things. You know, they could take you out for dinner on their off hours and talk to you as just a private person to private person and tell you these things. But when they've got their coat on and they're in their office and they're in that professional capacity, there's all sorts of things they're not allowed to tell you that would benefit you, the patient.
You know, and I do want to say we're not trying to dog anybody out, but it's just the reality of the situation. So just kind of know that. Don't get defensive if you have I have an uncle who's a doctor and I love him to death. He's one of those that really cares about his patients. And I get to talk to doctors off the books.
Yeah.
My uncle used to do a lot of lobbying for women's health in the, you know, at the government level. And he truly, truly cares about women's health. And I get to hear all these doctors say all the things off the books, yeah. You know, which is very, very fun. Not a lot of people have that experience. And like, I understand like the medical world, the people that go in really do care.
Oh, yeah.
But their hands
it's
are
just
tied.
Like teachers.
At the end of the day, we just really want to emphasize that you own your health outcomes and you have to do the research yourself. And that's really what it comes down to, is the more that you can control, the better off you're going to be.
Yeah. And I want to stress that too, that I'm not saying that there aren't good people in the medical industry that mean well. There's a bunch of people in the medical industry that mean well, but there's a bunch of amazing public school teachers that would love to teach and discipline their students, but they're not allowed to do it. And if they try to do it, they will lose their job. And so it's the same thing with the medical industry. There's a lot of good people that would love to help people be healthy
and
help people be healthy and heal and fix problems, but their particular profession. That's what I'm trying to be honest, but I'm also trying to be respectful. I mean, they're in a commercial scenario, and if they wish to remain in that commercial scenario, they have to play by the rules. And all I'm saying is those rules, the reality is those rules prevent them from helping their yeah. patients a lot.
And a lot of doctors are getting out because they can't stand, they're going to a cash pay model. They're doing like a monthly, you know, a monthly fee, and you get so many visits or so many calls and things like that out of it because they want to be able to practice medicine. Yeah. So the things are shifting. There's a huge shift going on massively. You know, my uncle was an OBGYN, so delivered lots of babies, and he got insuranced out of being able to practice on his own. And now he's in a hospital because he still loves it, but it was $1 million a year for malpractice insurance. Mm. He was paying everybody else and taking zero home.
Yeah.
You know, and this is just the reality of the medical world right now. And then when the government got involved in healthcare, all of a sudden doctors couldn't practice medicine anymore. They have to practice to insurance. So they're not able to help the way that they used to, you know, and that's why it's just so important that everything that you can do yourself, you learn how to do. Because at the end of the day, there's only so much that they can do, but you can do exponentially more yourself. I say this on my website. I read this stat a long time ago, and it has not changed from what I've seen, that doctors are only responsible for about 10 to 20% of your health outcomes. So that's structural, right? It's not chronic, that's structural. They are responsible for 10 to 20%. So that means 80 to 90% of your health outcomes literally depend on yourself.
Mm-hmm.
So that's where we are coming from, is like, we just want you to know what you need to know, what you need to be researching to be able to be the healthiest version of yourself. And this is what it takes. And there's a lot involved, and it's super overwhelming, but I hope that what you get from this is that it's doable. And hopefully you get some places to start and understand it's a process. It takes years.
It's a process. It's a mindset. You have to, you know, like I'm just, you know, I mean, at the end of the day, I'm still the same 14-year-old punk rock skateboarder that I've always been. And I don't like deception. You know, I don't mm-hmm. like people playing games. Some of my favorite people in life have been, my wife would get this, but some of my best friends, you would look at them and go, why in the world are these your best friends? Because they're not like you at all. But the reason they're my best friends is they're raw and they're real and they're honest and they're not trying to pull anything. And that's my hope for just humanity in general is I hope more and more people, as people learn their way forward, as their eyes are opened to more things, that we embrace the rawness and just the realness of interacting with each other. There are some things that, like, you might need to say to me that I might not want to hear, but if you're telling me these things and you're doing it honorably and you're doing it truly for my betterment or in my best interest, then I can't do anything but respect that and love you back and maybe someday be able to repay the favor and do the same for you. I don't know. That's where I think the profit and the profit motive, the commercial, you know, when something goes into the commercial realm, all that realness, all that rawness is stripped away. It's not about that anymore. It's about turning a profit. And unfortunately, that is what the medical industrial complex is based on, is turning a profit.
Well, you know, we're running out of time, but I really want to talk about this. I remember when Bayer, bought out a whole bunch of holistic supplement mm-hmm. companies, you know, Garden of mm-hmm. Life. And there was a few others, and I was just absolutely heartbroken, because as soon as these small family owned businesses that have a heart for giving you the best quality product possible get bought out by a huge corporation, the quality goes down. Bragg's apple cider yep. vinegar is no longer cloudy. There's no longer a mother nope. in it anymore, you know, and it's absolutely devastating. Like, and I think about like Dave's Killer Bread and what it used to be compared to what it is now.
A fantastic off the shelf product before it got gobbled up.
And it's just not anymore. And yeah, it got gobbled up. Yeah. And this is happening with supplements and vitamin companies. And
that's why, you know, like, I think a huge topic, and obviously we don't have time, but sourcing. You could take anything that you're putting on or in you, get more into the sourcing, like know where that stuff is coming from. And if at all possible, try to find a source that is not a retail source, like find a direct source. If you're going to get eggs from somebody who's, you know, got the chickens. If you're going to get supplements, get supplements from, I mean, there's all sorts of people who make supplements, you know, I mean, that's a, that supplements is a big, big, big world. I mean, I take all my, because I know my eggs are coming from just the most amazing source. So I save all my eggshells and some of it I crush and use for gardening purposes, but I'll powderize some of that. I make my own calcium. Yeah. Tablets. I mean,
that's a huge one.
Yeah. Yep. Yeah. And I mean, you don't even, if you're eating eggs and those eggs are coming from a healthy source, save those eggshells, put them in a coffee grinder and you've got calcium right there. You've got calcium for you, your pets, you know, you can throw it in your plants. You know,
I remember learning that and it was just like incredible. Like I'm trying to remember what she told me, but she's like, you disinfect them, you soak them in lemon juice, you peel off the skins on the inside, right? The membrane, and then you crush them. And it's one of the best sources of calcium you can get because it has all these other minerals in it that prevent it from becoming stones mm-hmm. in your body. So it's not just calcium, yeah. but it's a bioavailable, usable source with all the other minerals required to make it usable. And it was like mind-blowing.
Most people are throwing them away.
Are you freaking kidding me?
Yeah. Yeah. And then like go on, you know, go on Amazon or whatever and look and see what they're charging for calcium supplements, you know, high-end calcium supplements.
And then they're recommending that women don't take calcium because it becomes hardened in our arteries. For women specifically, this happens if you take a calcium supplement. And it's like, well, how am I supposed to protect my bones?
Yeah.
Well, there's so many other ways. So that's like, I have so much in my brain that, I mean, we could literally talk about this for hours, but we have given people a ton of food for thought. We've probably blown a few minds and they're like, do I really want to keep listening to this and going down this rabbit hole? I promise that you do. But again, thank you so much for coming on and talking with me.
Absolutely. Hey, I got something free for your audience if they want. So if you go to theredpillrevolution.com/guide, we've got this anti-dependency guide here. And I put this together and I tried to make it like visually fun to go through, but it's just, it takes you through 10 steps of life that we all have the ability to control. And hopefully there's at least two or three things in there that'll make you go, whoa, I didn't realize that, you know, that was kind of the whole point. And I'm not gathering and saving emails of yours to spam out. This is really just what I think one of the biggest things that I really get enjoyment out of is just sharing knowledge, and it's just a pure knowledge share. So theredpillrevolution.com/guide, just go ahead and download that. And I hope that there's at least a couple things in there that would make you just go, whoa, that's interesting. So
it's a great guide, I will say. And the book is fantastic. Highly recommend buying the book. Again, it's just, if you love learning and you want to know what you don't know, it's a great book to get started. And they're coming out with the Red Pill Revolution food.
Yes, that will be out shortly, and that's going to be a history of food and the human relationship with food and how that has changed, you know, from an ancestral relationship to this commercial weird relationship we now have food. It's a deep dive and it should be a fun read. So I mean, thank you for the kind words on the previous book. I appreciate that.
Oh yeah, thank, and like I said, I love having you on and having these conversations. It's so good, and I look forward to having you back again and just taking people even further, because there's more to go, you guys.
Say when and I'm there. Marian, thank you so much for having me. You've got a great thing going, and I'm just glad to be part of it in a little way.
Thank you so much for hanging out with me today. If you found this episode helpful, would you do me a favor and help others find it by leaving a review, sharing a screenshot on social media, or sharing the link with a friend? By you sharing what you've learned, others are able to find this podcast and join our community. Be sure to check out my website, www.roadtolivingwhole.com, for over 160 delicious recipes, a variety of meal plans, and a blog packed full of even more healthy living tips. If you'd like to learn more about how to work with me as your coach, you can schedule a free consult through www.roadtolivingwhole.com/health-coaching/. Until next time, friend. Bye.